An event which tests and rewards our brainstorming activity. Henceforth, I sincerely applaud and welcome all the brainies present here. It's our honor to have with us three esteemed judges who will guide, judge, and reward our students. We have today among us the Deputy General Manager of Sydney, Ms. Prafulla Shenoy, who has her work experiences in various departments in IDBI, SIDBI, in the Treasury, Resource Management, Accounts and Credit sections at various centres like Mumbai, Pune, Indore and Rajkot. A pleasure to have you, ma'am. I request our Principal, Dr. K.J. Pandey, to give a floral welcome to Prafulla, ma'am.
I request Mr. Dhaval Motwani to give a formal welcome to Chetan sir. We also have at our midst Mr. Abhijit Wala, Assistant Professor at Christ College. He has been with Christ for more than 10 years, has 14 years of academic experiences, has presented 8 papers, and has also authored a book and co-authored 3 other books. Pleasure to have you, sir. I request Mr. Joy D'Souza to give a formal welcome to Abhijit, sir. SYBBA. 3 minutes of thinking and 3 minutes for presentation. And you will be judged on 4 criteria: identification of problem, presentation of idea, innovative ideas, and feasibility of idea. So, all clear? A consignment of 20,000 metric tons of soya bean extractions used for manufacturing cattle feed was sold to Messrs. Alfred Marshall Exporting House in Rotterdam. The price was $150 per metric. The freight charges to be paid by you is $75 per metric from Mumbai to Rotterdam. After due quality checking and custom clearance, the consignment was shipped to Rotterdam in a Russian vessel. At Rotterdam Anchorage, before unloading the cargo quality surveyors found out that the entire cargo was contaminated and fungi and no more fit to be used as cattle feed. The consignee rejected the material to be purchased at the contractual price. After much deliberations, they agreed to purchase the cargo at a reduced price of $50 per metric. What would be your next step of action at this juncture?
My first step would be to apologize to the to Miss Alfred Marshall, because we wouldn't have this problem wouldn't have happened if I wouldn't have checked properly. Then secondly, I would try to suggest a more advantageous situation where both of us have an agreeable contract. While the $50 per metric tons is not sufficible. So I would actually offer another deal that will send you half new consignment in exchange of you paying complete bill, and then I would use the expired soybean extraction to a better usage. I would try finding something that will make this recyclable, and I think that's it.
Now, as an export executive, what would be your first reaction for making the financial losses reduced? What would be your first, one thing you will do to see that your company doesn't face the losses?
Well, first of all, I would put myself online, and I would try to contribute myself what I have earned in protecting my company and putting up the cost again. And then I would try to find ways that will help me get cash. I might actually start a side business that will help me acquire the cash which was initially lost.
No, as an export executive, what would be your first duty to see that the financial losses, which is already being now hovering, how it can be reduced? Is it not proper for you to, you know, just look at the papers which is already being submitted while shipping this consignment?
Well,
Which papers you would emphasize?
I would emphasize on the second paper, because first paper was clearly stated that I have already checked. But the client is my responsibility. My first responsibility is my client. And if something is causing a disadvantage or a discomfort to my client, I am supposed to be sure that the client is at comfort zone with me. So I would try to look at the second paper, and I would try to make sure that these problems do not occur again, and my client is always satisfied. So I would basically look over the second paper.
Do you look at the insurance paper if you feel like?
Yes.
It has not leaked.
Okay. If the paper of the case is with you, first tell me, who is your client here?
Miss Alfred Marshall.
That is the one who is exporting.
Was sold to Miss Alfred Marshall.
It was sold to them.
Yes.
Alright, it was a Mumbai firm. And who are you?
I am the exporting executive. I sold my feed to Miss Alfred Marshall, who is exporting it for them.
It is not your feed, you are a shipping company.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
So you are only a transporter.
Yes, I'm a transporter.
You suggested you will give half the quantity extra.
Yes.
It's not yours.
Okay, yeah. I failed to understand the problem.
All right, that's it.
Thank you.
We'll
try.
The management of a reputed company, having an asset base of Rs. 25,000 crore, has decided to substitute 40% of its unskilled labors by robots, which caused to the outbreak of a severe labor strike for the loss of employment, and subsequently the company declared lockout. Give an amicable solution which makes both the sides happy.
Good afternoon, judges and my friends. First of all, I will clarify what is the main problem of this case. The main problem of this case is the, I can say, is the technology. Because of the, if you imply technology in the company, there the laborers are getting unemployed. That is the main problem. And laborers are they are on the strikes, and same way the other side, that is the management, also carries out the law. So I would like to give the solution that as the company is already a reputed company, is already has a base of 25,000 crore, so the laborers might has in their mind that of course in the future time also they will go for the technology only, because they already have the base of 25,000 crore. Again, if you think the company has to talk with the they have to get the demands of the laborers, that is, and they also have to put their own situations, and they both have to clarify a middle way out, that is, they can also increase the product line of their that is of the company. By increasing product line, they can also involve the 40% unskilled labor they have unemployed. They can get the employment in the different product line that they have increased. Other thing was that they can carry on is with the training programs. They can go for the training programs that will make the laborer skilled, and that can be used in the different product line, or the trainings program only will create the self-employment opportunities with them. They will, if they go out in the market, they can get the self-employed. They have to just take the middle way out. They have to, management has to ask what is the requirement, and they have to fit, they can adjust up to their limits that they can support them. And they have to support them, and we have to use the technology. We have to use the robots, because they were already unskilled laborers, and they are now recruiting them, means using robots. So they need it will also create less cost. So they can go for the training program also, and they can also increase the product line also. And other way also, while making the robots, that the company, they might get unemployed from the right now from this company, but in the cycle of the this robot making procedure, they will be somewhere or other where employed. That is, they will be either employed in making of the robots, they either might be employed in the transportation that robots will be carrying to their industry. So they will get employed.
Few years down the line, this typical case is replicated in a very famous industrial house, that is Bajaj Auto Limited. Rajiv Bajaj came all the way from USA after doing his masters, and he propagated an idea that now India is ready with the youth market, and Hamara Purana Bajaj, Jo Priya, Vaspa, Jo Purana two wheeler tha, now that is going to be extinct. So all that they have done is started a new product line called Bajaj as a motorcycle. Initially, they have started tying up with Kawasaki for the technology transfer. Subsequently, they go on their own, having the skilled laborers. At that given point of time, all these laborers who are accustomed to, you know, assemble the Bajaj scooter, they are being given an option of VRS. So 7,000 workers, whatever the salary they are going right now, till the date of retirement, entire package offered by Bajaj. Bajaj has severely lost on the financial extraction because of huge payout. But the new product line which is being developed by Rajiv Bajaj, you understand now that Bajaj is probably one of the biggest motorcycle manufacturers in the world. So this typical situation where 40% of the laborer, which is at risk of, you know, losing their job. As industry executive, what you will do to soothe the feeling of the remaining 60% laborers? 40% they are at risk. They are probably will be kicked out. We are for the interest of the company, not for the laborers. You are from company side, not from the laborers side. So what you will do to retain the 60% who will be having some sort of an insecurity in their mind?
The remaining 60% for the insecurity, sir, they will be, we can go for their signing a contract with them for the giving them a security for the job itself for the 2 or 3 years. We will make the contract so that they will feel job security in their self and they will work with their motivation. Another thing also, they can we will have the different training programs, as I said, that if they will get out from this area, they will again get the opportunities in the different area that might be the stronger opportunities than this, so that they will not get motivated and they will work in the company.
You have been appointed as the chairman of Gujarat State Road Transportation Corporation. You have been assigned a task of devising strategies to increase the revenue from the road transport. Conducting a survey, you realize that the private bus companies are gaining from the major slot of daily passengers. At the same time, the revenue generation of the state exchequer from the private buses is very less because of the faulty road transport laws. As a chairman of GSRTC, what suggestion can you put forward for increasing the revenue generation for road transport?
Good afternoon. As a chairman of GSRTC, all I can do is, I cannot apply for changes in the law, but I can make changes in our transportation services to increase our and attract more number of customers. And as we see, the daily passengers are generally the students and the people who commute for the job. They do require many facilities that are not provided by neither private companies nor GSRTC. So including that type of services like free Wi-Fi, plus increasing the number of slots. Sometimes they are late because of some, as if today, I will be in this particular competition, so I might get late. Rather than 1:30, I would reach at 2:30. So increasing the number of slots and increasing the number of vehicles in a particular particular path can attract more customers. And as we see that private companies have a fixed routes, that they are having kind of a cartel, that some particular firms go to this particular route only. For example, at the Bhavnagar route, only Gujarat Travels works. So taking benefit of their cartel, we can take it as a benefit by including all the slots, providing all the slots and at a regular point of time, and plus providing various facilities like Wi-Fi, plus we cannot include refreshment because that would cost us quite high. But all we can do is improve our facilities, at bus facilities, and the time taken to travel can be improved. And so that more slots are there, people will prefer our particular GSRTC. So that's going to be done to attract more customers.
The question was, how are you going to improve your road transport tax laws?
We are GSRTC chairman. We are the bus operators. We cannot go to legislatives to change the law. That is in the hands of government. We are just an organization, and we have to improve our facility to attract more customers. We cannot change the rules that government is already, and that is in the hands of. Yeah, we can do is that we can suggest government that we are facing this problem. And if you can check out on rules and if you can modify them for the betterment of government as well as people, because what private companies do is they compete price competition. They cutthroat, because of cutthroat competition, they are decreasing the quality and they are also decreasing the safety of passengers. As we see, Patel and Eagle, they are competing because also on the, they are on a price war. And for price war and maximizing the slots, they are going at a faster speed, which is not safe for the road.
This is probably a competition for, you know, doing a jugaad. give me one jugad idea. If you are a private bus operator, what you will do, not as a GSRTC, but as a private bus operator to compete with GSRTC. So that GSRTC chairman will, combat that idea. Give me one idea, one liner. What you will do to increase your revenue?
As a private?
Yeah.
You know, youth today, they are so fond of internet. And all they need is internet.
Yeah.
They don't need anything.
Correct.
They are going away from books, going away from television. All you can do is simply provide Wi-Fi facility, and everyone is done. Every place you see, any coffee shop, any particular thing, free Wi-Fi attracts more customers than anything.
Okay.
That's what I feel. And as a student, I've seen that many people are at T-Post. While they are doing good, T is normal, nothing special. But free Wi-Fi is the thing that attracts more number of customers rather than T.
Okay.
So
if my fellow jury members permit me, I'll give you a jugad idea. I'll give you. You start selling tickets for standing passengers, which is half of the price. That's simple?
Yeah.
There are passages which are being kept idle while you are traveling, or people are paying full freight and they are not getting a seat. You will have half of the price, so people will be queuing up. Those who are not affording the private buses, they will say that we will be doing all the way 3 hours, we will be standing and we will be paying 150 for Ahmedabad.
Plus we can add is they don't have any facility of passes.
Yeah.
We can add that to include
very good.
Add more number of buses.
Now your jugad mind has started working.
Yes, sir.
Good. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Our next contestant is Sagar of TYBBA and his is case number 3. An employee notices that workers who use catalyst A in a manufacturing process habitually violate safety protocols. This is quite disturbing since the student knows that catalyst A is carcinogenic. When he informs his supervisor of this and recommends another catalyst B, his supervisor tells him that this is not something with which he should be concerned. Besides, the supervisor adds, he knows about catalyst B and would never consider substituting it because it is much more expensive. How will you manage the situation?
Good afternoon to one everyone present here. I'm the employee and the manufacturing process by catalyst A is harming. And a student knows, so it is harming, and so I got to know about that it is unethical, and so this practice should be stopped. So I had gone to my superior, recommending him for the catalyst B, and this simply shows that with the answer of my superior, he simply tells me that I am just not concerned about it. That is not my work. That is not my lookout. And by the manufacturing process by catalyst A, it is providing more funds and more profits than I had recommended by the catalyst B. So my superior tells me that the profit margin will go down and the cost will be incurred. So I should not be concerned about that, and catalyst A should be carried on. But it is against my own ethics. I should inform each and everyone, go higher than that this is not the process. Only to earn profits, you cannot just play with anything, like you cannot go against ethics. So keeping ethics in mind and keeping the security of other things, even I would go further. Even if I lose my job, even on the basis of losing my job, I would aware people about it, and what is to be done, I'll do it. Because even if I lose job, I won't have a problem, because I won't let anything wrong happen. Kuch achha karne se daag lagte hai to daag achhe hai.
So if ultimately if you don't remain on job with the solution that you give me, because as it sounds that the replacement of catalyst A is not acceptable. Right, and most likely, as you judged it, if you object to it, you lose your job. How do you fight a battle not being in there?
If I am not at my job, sir, awareness is such a thing. I talk to people that this thing in the company is going wrong, and media today, media is such a thing that it can just go like fire. So I'll take the help of media, make people aware of it, and I'll go on with it. Even if I'm outside the company, I'll tell people that this is wrong, it is ethically wrong, you please stay out of it. And I'll take media support for that.
There are many processes which is having a lot of risk. Like yes. a fireman who go for seizing the fire, he is at risk of his life.
Yes.
There are unskilled laborers who go into the well, yes, and they blast the detonators for getting the water.
Yes.
What is your role in taking this catalyst be propagated in the company rather than making the employee who is habitually violating the safety protocols for using of catalyst A?
I'm sorry, sir, I couldn't get
it. Is it not appropriate for you to get a training process for the employee who violates the safety protocols rather than pressing hard and going to the media and making this catalyst be
As you can come to the case below, I went for that thing. I had a discussion. I gave suggestions to my superior.
I'm giving
training to the A and make it change, like make it like the catalyst B. Hmm. But sir, the supervisor thinks that it by doing that it can incur more cost, then why should that is just not important for the company. If that is being done without incurring any cost and we are generating profits, then what is the need to work over that and spend over that? So simply it is already told by my superior that it is not needed, sufficient profits are coming out, we don't need to do anything. So at that point of a time only, I'm thrown out of the company that if I go further. So I don't get chances to do that further.
Okay. Fine, thank you.
Our next contestant is Saurabh Singh. You have received your first assignment as a wedding planner in an event management company. All the booking has been done, including an open-air party plot for the reception. One day before the wedding, there happens very heavy rainfall. The party plot is now filled with water up to 6 inches. You cannot ask for more money from your client. How will you manage the situation?
Good afternoon, GA panel. Well, my case is a little more tricky. The rain has occurred and the party plot is filled with up to 6 inches water. So first thing, I will inform my client about the situation that the party plot is filled with 6 inches water, so we have to arrange a party to a different place. Secondly, I would find a suitable place for the party. It can be an open air part, party plot. So I would, in the nearby vicinity, I would try to find a place suitable for the party. Then if I find a suitable place, then first thing I will do, inform the client that now party has been shipped to that particular place. Then all the arrangements would be made by then. Since I cannot ask for more money, so whatever budget I have to arrange the things. I will decorate the place with the maximum as possible. Have food facilities, arrangements, etc. So this is how I will manage the situation.
This is something beyond your control. Wouldn't you negotiate with the party?
If I negotiate, I will lose.
Why you will lose? But this is an unanticipated or unexpected event.
It is an unexpected event, but as he is my client, it's my duty till the time the reception is not concluded fully. So it's my duty to help him out.
Helping is one thing. But then why are you saying that all the losses of water is going to be solely your responsibility? This is something which you have not anticipated, or even the client has not anticipated.
Yeah. I would be sorry for that, but not the losses also is mine, because lot is filled with water, so nothing can be done for that. So the best option is to arrange the situation or find a plot near it, have a reception. Indeed, for going a quarrel or a query, it's just a waste of time.
Suppose you are in a reverse situation. You are the client and you have an event manager who has come with this problem. How do you react?
Since it's
now you are the client,
yes,
you're not the event manager, and your event manager comes with this issue in front of you. You know what the situation is.
I would ask him for if he can help me out for the other arrangement, for any other place in the vicinity, means nearby, so that the function can be held. I would ask him, since it's not my fault as well as his fault, it's a natural calamity.
That's what
medical
say.
Yeah.
Fine, good.
Next contestant is Preet Malhi, and hers is case number 8. You are the HR manager of a mill which will close down in 12 months, but the owner wants you to ensure that until it closes the mill should work full time. For that, you are hiring a production manager. The best candidate out of applicants is from Himachal Pradesh. The candidate asks you about the future of the mill and his career, as he doesn't want to shift from his hometown to find out another job soon. What will be your answer?
Good afternoon, everyone. Myself, Preet Malhi, I'm from BA department. So my topic is regarding the candidate. The best candidate out of the applicant is from Himachal Pradesh. So I will make him aware about the situation which I'm in, and ask him how, if he wants to continue the job, and I will pay him more than needed, and I'll give him I will see if he agrees with me, and if it doesn't work out, so I will see if I have other candidates in my list. So I will make sure the candidate is from that place where the factory is, and
contestant is Bridge Sage, and his is case number 6. Your company has recently entered into a cooperative venture with a Japanese firm. A team of Japanese engineers has come to your plant to teach your team engineers a new manufacturing process. However, the senior member of this team, a Japanese engineer with very traditional cultural views, refuses to work with a female member of your team, despite the fact that she is a highly qualified engineer, without whom they will remain incomplete. What strategy will you adopt to get this female engineer into the training program?
Good afternoon, everyone. Well, this is a cooperative venture, so the benefits will be received by both the companies, and we cannot simply cancel this venture because of this problem. And also we can see that the Japanese engineer was of traditional value, and we cannot change his viewpoint. If he believes it, then we have to appreciate it, and we have to deal with it. We cannot change it. The team member, that is the lady team member of our team, is highly qualified. So it is also that her participation in this venture is also a must. So this is also a point. So we have to find a middle way out. What I suggest is that we can make a smaller groups. Like suppose they are working all in a one group, then we can make two groups, and in one of the group there will be that old Japanese engineer, and in another group we will place our lady employee, so that they can enhance their skills, and also they can develop, and the training program will happen smoothly. Also, what I suggest is that like the suppose it's a technical work, the woman is doing a technical work in the manufacturing process, and it's not specified, but I am adding it. And if the same work of advanced level is to be, you know, taught by that engineer, then what we can do is we can put an assistant, not assistant, but a kind of a mediator type of person who can first of all learn the skills from the engineer, and then he can teach to our employee. This is also a middle way. That's all.
Do you feel like having any role of information technology on this?
Yes, sir, we can do this. Here it's specified that he can not work with the woman, you know, closely, but we can use some telephones or communication methods to train her. This can also be done.
Do you feel like would it be a good solution for training a woman through some other mode of training rather than one-on-one?
Yes, sir. If it's if the job is such that where training can be like provided without being one-on-one, then it's okay. We don't have any issues. After all, it's for the benefit of the company, and we can make certain compromises to, you know, it's the middle way, and we cannot directly make we cannot take extreme steps.
Thank you, Bridge. Our next contestant is Parth Upadhyay, and his is case number 7. You are an HR consultant. You have been invited to a well-reputed company to solve an internal issue. The manager of the company, since its inception, with his hard work, developed the company as one of the most reputed organizations. The assistant manager, female, wanted to overthrow the manager for her personal gains and for the position. Her major issue was that her ego power needs was not getting satisfied, and the manager was reluctant to introduce her false policies and her approach to the subordinates. She made an illicit team, persuading few employees by various means, and submitted a grievances notice to the top management demanding the removal of the manager. The top management was not in favor of removing the manager. What HR strategy can you suggest to the management for solving this problem?
Good afternoon, everyone. The problem of the case is that the assistant manager wants to remove the manager from his post for her personal gains. What I can do is I can meet the employees who are in her influence and ask them what's the problem with the present manager. The manager has already boosted the company and made the company reputed, so they can also make false mistakes there is any problem in his skills. So the top manager management also don't want to remove the manager. So the only solution it can be done is that to remove the assistant management manager as she is selfish and wants to remove the manager for her personal gains. अगर एक गंदी मछली पूरे तालाब को गंदी करती है तो उस मछली को ही निकाल देना चाहिए.
They are not in a position to remove her. What will be the plan B?
She can be de-promoted, or she can be.
As an HR consultant, what you will do? You will be straight away, you know, throwing the dead lady out of the organization. That would be your suggestion, or would you do
can,
some?
We can give her some time to take a complaint back.
No, it's an attitudinal issue about her. Yes. That she has some egocentric needs, which will make her comfortable by overthrowing the manager. Manager is indispensable in the organization. Now, what you will do to strengthen the team which will work for the benefit of the company? What you will do?
We can ask other employees if they are comfortable with her or not.
Asking is not a solution. I am asking for a solution. What you will do to make the things better in the organization? I'll give you an idea. Straight away talk to the female and give her the exact idea of what is hurting the company. If she is career centric, she is already an ego power centric. Now, the management should tell her that if the company grows, there will be a second position will be created as a manager. Right now, you are not fit for that. But if you work hard with the synergy of all the people, including the manager, you can be, have a dream of being promoted. That motivation will create her working for the company and not for her egocentric needs. Correct?
Thank you.
Judges, please note that our last contestant, Jainal Nakara, is not present. So we are done. Thank you, all the participants. Once again, a round of applause for all of them. I call upon the convener of the event, Mr. Jory D'Souza, to set forth the vote of thanks.
Good afternoon, everybody. How many of you have heard the term Jugaad? What exactly is Jugaad? Solution. Solutions to what?
Kuch bhi karke
answer nikale.
Kuch bhi. So should that be legal or ethical or unethical? Hook or crook, whatever. Okay. Fine. The idea of Jugaad, keep this term Jugaad. We are searching for talent hunt, and that came from this book called Jugaad. This is the book. I'm not marketing the book, but the book is really good. So this is the book from which we talked about the concept Jugaad. Jugaad literally means an improvised arrangement, a workaround that has been used because of lack of resources. Okay? Jugaad innovation incorporates 6 different principles. They are: seek opportunity in adversity, do more with less, think and act flexibly, keep it simple, include the margin, and last, follow your heart. If you have the gusty ability to improvise, you might recognize yourself as a Jugaad minded. Jugaad innovation is not about being afraid to fail, but experiments are allowed. It literally boils down to something called out of the box thinking. I would give a very beautiful example which says, Jugaad thinking is the idea of mobile money. How? About 2.5 million grown-ups around the world do not have access to bank or bank accounts, but many people do have a mobile phone. In Africa, there are currently even more mobile phones than toys. So you can guess what would be the WhatsApp chats and they all, you know. So when a child is born, he would be gifted mobile phones and toys. Some Jugaad-minded people came across the idea, use these mobile phones to send money. Withdraw money, pay goods without having an own bank account. So this is something which is, you know, you can think about. Jugaad comes out when you have adversity of resources. How best, how perfect you plan, there's always something lacking, there's always something scarcity of resource. How you manage that scarcity of resource and how you come up with something excellent to manage the situation is called Jugaad. I have a small video, 2-minute video I would like to be played. Before we move on to the video, I would invite our judges to express their feedbacks on our today's session.
Some of them had good ideas. Some I felt did not actually understand it. Maybe lack of exposure or lack of confidence in coming US. But another opportunity.
Thank you. Thank you, ma'am.
For me, Christ Institute is now my second home. Last 1 month, I am here for the third time, and every time I am, you know, being very well welcomed. Thank you, all students and the faculties, you know, showing such much wonderful love to me. I am really very, very happy seeing bright faces again and again. The Jugaad competition is probably, you know, an ignition point for this institution. In fact, people have, by and large, lost the faculty of, you know, thinking out of the box. Simple solutions are, you know, apparent, and in very harsh world out, simple solutions are not acceptable. If you want to become a winner, you'll have to think out of the box. You have to give such an absurd idea which may, you know, click and make you someday Bill Gates or, you know, the Murthy, Narayan Murthy kind of. If they have thought all throughout their life what they are experiencing, like one girl has given an idea about, you know, the Bharat tourism ke liye, jo pura concept TV pe dekha hai, you replicate it. You won't be a successful Jugaad creator. You have to think very, very different kind of a thing. There you can think of, you know, Rajkot has tremendous food varieties that can be marketed worldwide, so that anybody who coming to India may think of, you know, having a gathia, a very popular recipe which is not being very popular across the country, across the world. So this type of Jugaad probably student must think, and they must come out with their own innovative ideas, rather than, you know, replicating what is being heard, what is being read, and what is being seen in the society. I think all students take a tip out of this entire proceeding, that they must think out of the box. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
I'm as much a host. I think as far as this event is concerned, very well organized. Of course, I am very much a part of it as well. But sir has been very precise on what he has said. Quite often, theoretical thinking gets you away from your creativity. The education system has a huge contribution to that as well. But I think by doing these competitions, we're just probably igniting that creativity back. And I guess efforts like this will make things, at least make the students think better, if nothing else. So yes, it's, you know, I mean, what can get you somewhere is only thinking out of the box. We are amongst billions of people, everybody thinking and wanting to do something, so you have to be out of the box. That's what I think. Sir has hit the nail on the head. I can just pamper it.
Thank you.
The old innovation paradigm is obsolete. More capital and more resources will not get you more innovation. What you need is a whole new mindset.
And the mindset is what we call Jugaad.
They're stuck with rigid processes like Six Sigma.
You can put in place a Six Sigma and then tell yourself that, you know, I'm going to schedule myself for 3 ideas on Wednesday and 2 ideas on Friday, right? That's not how creativity works. It's much more fluid and more improvised. But the reality is that most companies have continued to operate with mindset that more control means better productivity.
Just investing more in R&D or changing your processes won't make you more innovative. You really need to shed your traditional mindset and embrace a whole new mindset that's frugal and flexible.
Jugaad innovation seems to be in sort of a diametric sort of opposition to the dominant structured approach to innovation that we see in the West. You know, big R&D budgets, planned approaches to innovation, and innovation done in a somewhat insular way by people whose job it is to innovate.
I hope you had a very fruitful session and a rich experience and a very good feedback from our faculties and our industrialists. would help you to, you know, think something out of the box, something different from what is traditional. So it's time to thank everyone who have been here. I, on behalf of Christ Institute of Management, would like to thank our chief guest, Mr. Chetan Kothari, President, Rajkot Management Association, Ms. Prafulla Shenoy, DGM, SIDBI, Mr. Abhijit Wala, Professor, Christ College. Thank you, sir, for being here. Special thanks to our media partner, Gujarati TV, who will be broadcasting our event. My sincere appreciation to my dear colleagues, the students coordinator of Jugaad event, and the peons who are directly or indirectly involved in conducting this event smoothly. Thanking you for being a patient listener. This is Joy D'Souza signing off. Thank you.
Before giving the results, I call upon our principal, Dr. K.J. Thangachan. The fifth prize goes to Saurabh Singh. The fourth prize goes to Sagar. Please have a round of applause.